Good morning and welcome to Appleton Christian Church. So glad you could join us this morning as we come together to worship our God, to get lessons of life on how to live our faith. You know, as we come together, let's praise Him, let's lift Him up, let's enjoy the fellowship that we have, and know that even though you may be home listening to this, as we gather in the name of Christ, we want to encourage you toward love and good deeds. Always, let us know if there's something that you need from us. But as we come now, let's go ahead and pray and open up our service. Lord, open our hearts to minds to you and your leading. May you fill us with your Holy Spirit. May you be honored by our praise. May you change us by your word. We love you and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. Enjoy the service.
Now is the time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as are before your God. Come. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you. Come, now is the time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are before your God. Come. One day every tongue will confess you are God, and one day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. Every tongue will confess you are God, and one day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. Now is the time to worship. Now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are before your God.
our blessed Redeemer. Sing, O earth, His wonderful love proclaim. Hail Him, highest archangels in glory. Strength and honor give to His holy name. Like a shepherd, Jesus will guard His children. In His arms He carries them all day long. Praise Him, tell of His excellent greatness. Praise Him, ever in joyful song. Praise Him, Jesus our blessed Redeemer. For our sins He suffered and bled and died. He our rock, our hope of eternal salvation. Sound His praises, Jesus who bore our sorrows. Love unbounded, wonderful, deep and strong. Praise Him, tell of His excellent greatness. Praise Him, ever in joyful song. Praise Him, Jesus our blessed Redeemer.
Sing,
sing with me how great is our God, and all will see how great, how great is our God.
Interesting time. It's interesting to be a believer right now, and there's a lot of us asking questions like how do we live in this time? How do we live our faith in this time? How do we live with each other in this time? I mean, let's face it, the very air we breathe seems to want to kill us, right? The world around us doesn't like our faith. Seems like every day what we believe is under attack. Our morality, our belief system, our the things we hold dear seem to be objects of jokes or ridicule or scorn. And that's just here in our country. Brothers and sisters around the world, they're being killed for what they believe. And so we have to say, what do we do with this? How do we live? Today we're going to study a passage out of the book of James as we continue our study in James, where he's going to talk about how do we live in times of suffering? How do we live in times of stress? How do we live in times of pain? How do we live when we have so many questions? Where is God? Why God? Why is this happening? And so today, James is going to help us with those questions. He's going to teach us what it means to be a people of faith in the midst of struggle like this. And so we're going to go to James chapter 5. We're going to read verses 7 through 12, and we're going to learn what James says is the key to living like a people of faith in such uncertain and stressful times. So let's read that passage, and then we will study it and see if we can make sense of what James is trying to teach us. So James chapter 5, verses 7 through 12. Therefore, brothers and sisters, be patient until the Lord's coming. See how the farmer waits for the precious fruit of the earth and is patient with it until it receives the early and late rains. You also must be patient. Strengthen your hearts because the Lord's coming is near. Brothers and sisters, do not complain about one another so that you will not be judged. Look, the judge stands at the door. Brothers and sisters, take the prophets who spoke in the Lord's name as an example of suffering and patience. See, we count as blessed those who have endured. You have heard of Job's endurance and have seen the outcome that the Lord brought about. The Lord is compassionate and merciful. Above all, my brothers and sisters, do not swear either by heaven or by earth or with any other oath, but let your yes mean yes and your no mean no, so that you won't fall under judgment. This is a great passage from James. And I want us to kind of understand it. Now, in the next several weeks, we're going to go farther in chapter 5. We're also going to go back and fill in the rest of this book of James. So we're here at the end where James is summarizing his argument to give us an understanding of what he's talking about. Because what James is talking about, like we learned last week, is that we are a people of faith and we are to live out our faith. And so what does that look like? Well, he starts by saying, therefore. And as you know, every time you see the word therefore, you have to ask, what is that therefore, therefore? And so what James is doing is he's connecting this teaching with what came right before it. And briefly, what came before our passage is James talking about what it looks like to live a life of no faith. A life that says, I need to be my own savior. I need to provide for myself, that I need the work of my hands to have meaning. And so I will give them meaning. It's to chase after wealth and power and prestige and all these things. And he ends his argument, as we will see in a few weeks, by saying, look, what kind of person would chase after all these things that are going away? They're fleeting. They're going to rust or decay. They're going to corrupt. They're going to be eaten by moths. All these things will go away. And even worse than that, according to James, not only will they go away, but the pursuit of those things makes your heart change in such a way that you become an enemy of God and deserving of his wrath. And so to live without faith is to live in such a way where you are going to eventually lose all that you hold dear and gain the wrath of God. And James is saying, why would you ever do that? But since that's the reality of living without faith, therefore, brothers and sisters, let's live with faith. And so how does he say we should do that? Well, verse 7 says, therefore, brothers and sisters, be patient. Be patient until the Lord's coming. He starts off with a simple instruction, be patient. And that's hard. Let's face it, that's hard to be patient, especially as believers, because we believe some very certain things. As believers in Christ, we have certain beliefs that we have built our faith on. We believe that there is a God. We believe that this God loves us and cares for us. We believe that God sent his son to the world to die for us. We believe that through his death, burial, and resurrection, we have been given salvation. We believe that he will return again and make all things new. And we believe that we will spend eternity with our God in his presence, living in the treasure and the reward of living in faith now. And so we believe all these things to be true. And yet we believe waiting because Christ hasn't returned. We have for 2,000 years now as believers, we have done the work that God has prepared for us to do. We have sought to glorify his name and to be ambassadors of his gospel message. And yet we wait for that coming of Christ. And in that waiting, it's sometimes tempting to say, what's he waiting on? Why hasn't he come back? We look around the world and we see wars and rumors of war. We see famine. We see prejudice and hatred and injustice. So we're, what is Christ waiting for? When will he come back? And it's easy in those moments to lose our patience. And James's first command to us is to be patient. Because Christ is coming back. He reminds us of the truth that our faith is built on the truth of the Word of God. And the Word of God says Christ will return. So be patient. And then he gives us an example, an illustration, if you will. He says, look at the farmer. I'm not a farmer. And you might not be a farmer too, but we know what a farmer does, kind of, right? We know that a farmer has to prepare the soil and plant the seeds and tend the crops. In James's day specifically, they had to work hard without machines and all that, and they couldn't just open the irrigation up and water that crop. They had to do all this work in preparation in the hopes of rain that was going to come. It always had come, and so they trusted that it would come again. But we also have to remember that James is written to a people in a place and a time that were under suffering. And why were they suffering? One of the main reasons they were suffering is they were living during a famine. This is a church in Jerusalem living during a famine where the crops had failed. The rains didn't come. Now the farmers had done everything they could do, and yet the crops had failed. And so failing, it just shows the lack of control that farmers really have. It seems like they have all the control, right? They've prepared the ground, they have the seed, they put the seed in the ground, they keep the weeds away, they get ready to go. They should have all the control they need to make this crop work, this valuable crop work. And yet, if the rains fail, the crops fail. And he says, think of the farmer when you are reminded to be patient. Because as we work and do the work that Christ has called us to do, it's often tedious, toilsome work, it feels like, as we prepare fields and spread the seeds of the gospel and pray over the harvest and continue to disciple and weed out false teachings and do all these things that we've been called to do as we wait for the return of Christ. And it just seems like that return of Christ or the rain just is not coming. But like a farmer, we have to have faith that rain will come. And so James is giving us a reminder of the truth that the rain will come. Christ will return. How do we know it? Because by faith we believe all that we've been told. And by faith we know that Christ will return. And so like the farmer, don't give up. Don't stop working the fields. Don't start planting the seeds. Know that he will return. As a matter of fact, James reminds us that his coming is near. It's closer than we can imagine. It's right around the corner. It could be today. And so continue to do the work we've been called to do in faith and patience, knowing that he will return, because he is good and trustworthy, and we can rely on him. And James does something great now. What he does next is he gives an illustration. He's going to do this twice. He's going to give an illustration and then a little lesson to help us as believers do this together. And so our first illustration was the farmer. Our first lesson is this. Brothers and sisters, do not complain about one another so that you will not be judged. Look, the judge stands at the door. I love this. Because I don't know about you, but when I'm under times of stress, when things aren't going as fast as I want them to go, and my plans are being thwarted because and it's being revealed that I don't have control that I thought I had, my fuse gets a little shorter. My emotions get a little bit closer to the surface. And oftentimes, those closest to me are the ones who are gonna taste the bitterness of that, if you will. It's those who are closest to me that are gonna be the recipients of my frustration and my anger and my grumbling, if you will. James knows this. It's the tendency of people to look around when things don't go our way and to begin to look for someone or something to blame, to begin to grumble. And so James says, as we wait patiently, let's remember, we're in this together. And that lack of control you feel is the same lack of control I feel, the same lack of control that those around us feel. And yet we are a people of God called to live by faith. And all of us live by faith, knowing that God is in control. So let's don't look around and start grumbling and complaining about fellow believers. But let's be marked by faith, knowing that Christ is trustworthy and his return is imminent, and he at any time will show up, and all the work and all the toil that we've done will bear fruit, eternal fruit. And so in the meantime, let's don't look around and see who's to blame for that not happening yet. Christ will come in his time. Our faith tells us so. So let's don't complain. Let's don't judge. And for the second time, James reminds us that Christ is near. Look, the judge, Christ, is at the door. He's returning any moment. So let's be about his business, unified as a people in faith. Now he's going to give us our second example. Brothers and sisters, take the prophets who spoke in the Lord's name as an example of suffering and patience. See, we count as blessed those who have endured. You have heard of Job's endurance and have seen the outcome that the Lord brought about. The Lord is compassionate and merciful. Such an easy thing to read, but think about what James just said. Think of the prophets. Take the prophets, he says. Look at the prophets. Look how blessed they are. Now, I don't know how familiar you are with the scriptures, but when I read through the prophets, there's not many of them I would like to trade places with. I look at the life of a prophet and I think, yeah, that would be great to lay on my side for a couple hundred days. And, oh yeah, I want to cook my food over cow poop. That would be great. And when that couple hundred days is over, you know what? I'll just turn over and do it again. I look at a prophet and I say, yeah, wouldn't it be great to be hated by kings and queens, to be run out of town, to be have my life threatened, to have to live in the wilderness, to have to go to a widow and say, hey, before you die and your son dies, make me bread with the last of your grain. Wouldn't that be awesome? I would love to be the prophet that's hated by his own people, ridiculed, mocked, threatened, swallowed by fish. All of it sounds so pleasant. Aren't they so blessed? But remember the prophets? James calls us to remember the prophets when we are suffering, and we're suffering with patience as we are enduring the things of this world that seem to be against us. But why? Because the prophets spoke the very words of God. And you and I, as believers on this side of the cross, we are ambassadors. In other words, we are spokespeople for God. We have the words of God. We have the message of God. And we are called to take that message into this hostile world. And that message to the world reeks of death. Because since our message is true, and if you were an unbeliever, if our message is true, then that means death for me. And so the world tends to reject it, to ridicule it, to mock it, to hate it, to persecute it. Those who have the message of Christ in this world will suffer. And we live in a country where we have freedom, and it's great, but every day those freedoms seem to be under attack. Every day our faith seems to be something that is trying to be eradicated by the world around us. We're made a joke in movies and TV. The news talks about how we're bigots and filled with hate. Atheists talk about how we're just ignorant. And yet we know the truth of the gospel. Why? Because we have faith that this is true. We have faith built on the assurance and the past actions of God. We have faith built on the changes we have seen in our own life. We have faith based on the word that we have received. We have faith in God. And like the prophets, it'll cost us something to speak this faith. And yet the prophets endured. Why? Because their life was easy? Because they got lots of great earthly rewards? No. Because they were honored and privileged to be the spokespeople for God. Their connection with God was so strong. Their love for God was so strong. Their faith and trust in the God who had spoke to them was so strong that the world could throw nothing at them that would shake them, even to the point that they would die. And they did. So we remember the prophets because they're blessed. Not worldly blessed. They're blessed because they were used by God, and so are we. And so we endure suffering with patience and grace. And if that wasn't enough, he says, remember Job? Yeah, Job. It's a great story, right? Job, the man who seemed to have everything, and then one day Satan noticed him and comes in and says, "Have you considered Job?" Now, I'm paraphrasing, of course. You can read the book for yourself. And Satan accuses Job and says, "God, Job only loves you because you've given him all these good things. If you took those things away, he wouldn't love you more. He'd hate you. He'd despise you. He would reject you." God says, "Okay, then take those things, but you can't take his life." And so as we read through Job, we see that in the blink of an eye, Job loses his income and his family, his lands, his holdings, his power, his prestige. All of it is stripped away. His health is taken away in a moment. And through the book of Job, we see Job lying in mourning and lament, in pain and suffering, crying out, "Why, God? Why is this happening?" And the answer doesn't seem to come. And in the midst of his suffering, even his wife comes and says, "Job, just curse God and die." But Job refuses. Is he enjoying what he's going through? Absolutely not. Is he questioning why God? Absolutely. Does he ever question that God is good and merciful and compassionate? Never. He holds on and clings to the only thing that he has, which is God. And his neighbors and his family and the world around him that is left keep talking to him and saying that it's something you did and trying to blame him or trying to tell him to get rid of God or do something different. And Job refuses. You see, the reality of his situation didn't change what he knew about God. As he suffered and wept and cried out to God, why? He still trusted in God. And we are to remember him. And as we endure the things that this world throws at us, the loss of health, the loss of power, prestige, money, family, so many things that get taken away, so many things that at one time we had put our hope in that proved to be baseless, the only thing we can cling to is God. But the good news is our faith reminds us, and James reminds us, that our God is compassionate and merciful. That the experiences of this world don't define who God is. That God is compassionate and merciful, and in his compassion and in his mercy, he is with us. And the end of the story of Job is that God restores to Job 10 times all that was taken. It doesn't mean that Job didn't go through that suffering. It means that the reward at the end was great. And the good news for us, the good news that James is reminding us is no matter what we suffer in this world, our faith says the reward is so worth it. Because when Christ returns, the Christ who is near, then we receive our eternal treasure in heaven. We stand face to face with him where there is no more pain, no more tears, no more crying. When we are called by his name, that we are his people, that we are in the light of his glory, all of this will be a distant memory. All of this will seem as trivial in comparison to the glory that we receive in him. And so we continue to work and strive. We continue to struggle in this world. Why? Because Christ is coming, we are patient, and because our God is compassionate and merciful and has promised us that all things will work to the good, and we have faith in him. And now our second lesson. Right? Two examples, two lessons. Second lesson, above all, my brothers and sisters, do not swear either by heaven or by earth or with any other oath, but let your yes mean yes and your no mean no, so that you won't fall under judgment. The tendency for us, when things seem to be not going our way, when things seem to be nothing but suffering and pain, our tendency is to want to manipulate the situation to gain just a little more control, a little foothold, something we can say, we did this. And so we tend to make wild and outlandish oaths. You hear this all the time, especially oaths to God, like, "God, if you will just give me what I want, then I'll always serve you. I'll do what, I'll believe in you if you just." But we also do it with each other. We try to manipulate one another to get what we think we really need. I swear on my grandmother's grave, right? Whatever it is we swear by. What James is saying is knock it off. You're not in control. Everything you need, God will provide. Everything that you must have, God has given you. He's compassionate. He's merciful. He's coming. Remember your faith. Stop trying to manipulate the situation and trust in God. And just live with integrity. If you say you're going to do something, do it. If you say you're not going to do something, don't do it. Live in light of your faith of God with integrity to the world and to each other. Because the tendency for believers is when we get together in stressful times is to lose our patience and trying to get others to do what we want them to do. But as a community of faith, we are to patiently remember we are to do what the Lord is calling us to do and trust in Him and Him alone. See, James has a lot to say about what it means to live during a time of suffering. But his main message is this: live as a people of faith, patiently enduring whatever this world throws at you. Because as our faith reminds us, this is momentary. Christ will return and we will have an eternity with Him. And He is compassionate and merciful. So as we go through this together, let's go through it unified, loving one another with integrity, because all of us rely on one God to give us all that we need. I hope that you are blessed this week. I hope that no matter what gets thrown at you this week, that you can remember that you can trust God because He's in control. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank You for James. We thank You for the lessons that You give us. We thank You that You are control. And God, as this world continues to show us how little control we have, let us just continue to grow our faith in You, that You are merciful, compassionate, and that You are near. Come soon, Lord Jesus, and come find us doing the work You prepared for us to do in unity and peace with one another, trusting in You. It's in the name of Christ we pray. Amen.
My heart, oh God, make it ever true. Change my heart, oh God, may I be like You. You are the potter. And make me, this is what I pray. Change my heart, oh God, make it ever true. Change my heart, oh God, may I be like You. My heart, oh God, make it ever true. Change my heart, oh God, may I be like You. You are the potter. What I pray, change my heart, oh God, make it ever true. Change my heart, oh God, may I be like You. May I be like You.
we come time for this communion, we're going to do it a little differently online. Actually, we're going to take it together. So as I read the scripture, you can get your communion ready, and then we'll take this together. Out of 1 Corinthians 11, Paul had been talking to the church in Corinth, and talking to them about the amazing gifts they've been given, all these things that are going well in the church, and yet they were struggling with love. And Corinth had a wide range of wealth, I should say income distribution. Probably half the church was slaves, for the Corinth was a huge slave industry there in that city. And so Paul was talking to them about, you guys come together, you have fellowship, and some of the rich people are eating well and some people aren't eating anything, and that has nothing to do with the Lord's Supper. And so he tells them, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" And he goes on to explain to him, "Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. A man ought to examine himself before he eats of the bread and drinks of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without recognizing the body of the Lord eats and drinks judgment on himself. And that is why many among you are weak and sick, and a number of you have fallen asleep. But if we judged ourselves, we would not come under judgment." So as we come to this time, as we remember our Savior and the punishment he took for us, the death he took for us, and the life that he brought back through an empty tomb, as we come to this time, Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, as Paul wrote, took bread and broke it and said, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Dear Lord, thank you for your body, for living a life and going through what we have. For as you've written in Hebrews, we have a Savior who knows what we go through. Lord Jesus, thank you for the gift of your body and the promise of eternal life with you. In Jesus' name. And in the same way, he took the cup and he blessed it and he said, "Take this and drink. This is the blood of the new covenant shed for you. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." Lord Jesus, thank you for the gift of your blood as it cleanses us from sin and prepares us for heaven with you. May we honor you in all things. May we remember you and examine our own lives and the need for a Savior and take glory that we have one. We love you and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. As we come time for this offering to celebrate the gift God gave us that we can give back to him, one of the neatest stories about offering to me in scripture is the time that Jesus is in the temple and they've been testing him and going after him. And his disciples were standing with him, amazed at his teaching, and the people were amazed at his teaching, and even the Pharisees started backing off because, well, he was confounding them. He had an answer for everything. But in the middle of all that, he looks up, and he has a lesson for his disciples and for us. And he saw in Mark 12:41, we read, Jesus sat down opposite the place where the offerings were put and watched the crowd putting their money in the temple treasury. Many rich people threw large amounts, but a poor widow came and put in two very small copper coins worth only a fraction of a penny. Calling his disciples to him, Jesus said, I tell you the truth, this poor widow has put more money into the treasury than all others. And they all gave out of their wealth, but she, out of her poverty, put in everything, all she had to live on. You know, as we understand it and grow closer to God, we have an opportunity to really let him understand that we do trust him and we know he is the giver of all things. And to me, one of the best gifts he's given us is an opportunity to give back. Let's pray. Lord God, I thank you that you can point out that we can trust you, know you, and give you, Father, all that we have. May you bless these gifts and these as well as the givers. Use us and guide us in all things. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you again for joining us this morning. We're so blessed by you being with us. Continue to pray for our country, for our leaders, for your neighbor. Remember, as we live our life, live our faith, the light of Jesus Christ is being shown. Pray that God would open up people's hearts and minds and lead you to those who need you. Remember, we are here to be Jesus with skin on. Live your faith and let people see him in you. I love you. Have a great week. Be amazed by the work he can do in you and honor him in all things. Have a great week.